A style is when someone brings imagination, talent, and opportunity together at the same time. Busby Berkeley, specifically, created a sense of spectacle on screen and a sense of camera motion blended with that spectacle in a way that is so original and took us places that we never could have gone except in our dreams.
You know when someone becomes iconic, it's because what they've done or what they've accomplished is so specific to them. You know, we're going to do a Busby Berkeley, you know that means an elaborate dance number. That you know what that means.
He is such a part of our collective memory, and his images that he gave us are going to be recreated over and over in commercials, music videos, all of that.
When somebody asks you to describe what is the Busby Berkeley style, certain phrases and words come to my mind. Some of those would be patterns, formations, large groups of people dancing in unison steps, overhead camera shots that look down at the dancers, glorifying the American girl figure.
See, like props and costumes, you know, clearly there's a lot of numbers, but the costumes are specifically designed for that purpose, to twirl a certain way or come together in a certain way.
His manias is of black and white, you know, how he would use an all-white set or with one touch of black or all black where you just see a little bit of white. Everybody knew it was a black and white movie, big deal, but he made a black and white movie look better than any color movie.
He certainly, obviously had a great sense of space and dynamics.
He really did experiment with the huge crane shots, and they didn't have the technology that really was developed in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and now where we have robot cameras and remote control heads, things called hotheads, and all these different equipment that can do these amazingly snazzy shots. Then there were these big, clunky sound cameras and huge platforms. And I mean, it's one thing to conceptualize this stuff, but to realize it is something else. And that's where Berkeley was a visionary.
He tore a hole in Warner Brothers' ceiling. He could not go high enough. He really could not go high enough.
Berkeley, for effect, did a lot of things extremely. You had extreme close-ups of those beautiful girls and these huge, wide shots. He had no fear about space. He really used the frame in a very three-dimensional way, in, out, around, behind. He really was very avant-garde about the use of his camera.
He was a camera. He became a camera. I mean, the camera is you in those shots. No matter if it's zipping through a crotch or it's going up in the air, it's looking overhead. I mean, I tried to do a shot like that on The Dirty Shame. It came out fairly pitiful. It's really hard to do that. And those kaleidoscope shots, and I mean, no one had done that before. I mean, he really thought of really radical filmic moments.
By freeing the camera, he freed not only the creative imagination of directors, writers, performers, but more importantly, he freed the creative imagination of the audience.
Not only did he have this brilliant sense of what the camera could do for him, he had a great sense of what editing could do for him too. So when he shot, he would shoot the little pieces, knowing exactly where they were going to fit into the puzzle when it was all put together at the end.
But along with this spectacular dimension, there are other dimensions in Berkeley's work that are often overlooked. There are intimate dimensions, comic dimensions, romantic dimensions, poignant dimensions. You know, he could bring things down. He knew how to bring things down, how to move from the elevated to the commonplace so fluidly and so dazzlingly and so dizzyingly.
I always have this feeling that you're watching the number and Berkeley's going, eh, 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 you know, because it's just so impressive. And if you know anything about the process, it's overwhelming how hard it was, how really hard it was, and to make it look so easy. You know, that's the skill.
Still, to this day, in every movie that comes out today, you see that name all the time, Busby Berkeley S, even though he didn't direct most of the movies that these famous scenes are in. Some he did, but no one seems to realize that.
Gold Diggers of 35 is a milestone in Berkeley's career because it marks the first time that he directed a whole musical. 42nd Street and Gold Diggers of 33 and Footlight Parade are often called Busby Berkeley movies, but in fact the narrative parts were directed by other people like Lloyd Bacon and Mervyn LeRoy.
No matter who is the nominal director of the picture, there's always this kind of disjuncture between the narrative story as it's directed and the musical numbers. And that's just inevitable, because when you have somebody who's as imaginative as Busby Berkeley, his stuff is going to stand out from the rest of the picture.
At this time, the musical genre was changing. It was going away from the type of spectacular backstage musical and in a different direction. It was being carried on, most importantly, by the Astaire Rogers musicals at RKO. So, like Mark Sandrich, Berkeley makes the narrative world more like the musical world by stylizing it, particularly by setting everyday activities to rhythm.
It doesn't have the hottest script in the world, but Berkeley gives it a kind of snap and style that it wouldn't have had. I'm kind of reminded of Rob Marshall with Chicago, where you have a dance director doing the whole film and giving it a kind of unity.
He was truly a director. Whether he was dealing with people who were speaking text or dealing with a non-text segment of his work, he was always communicating a story.
We must go to the grocer's.
To the grocer's?
I might need an egg or two.
Then I'll bring home the bacon, or am I mistaken about going shopping with you?
Gloria Stewart takes Ruby Keeler's place in Gold Diggers of 1935. And clearly, she's not a musical performer, but she brings a real solid acting ability to the role.
Serenade you tonight, but the words are in my heart.
The Words Are in My Heart is a number in that romantic, elegant, geometric vein that also includes Shadow Waltz and Young and Healthy and By a Waterfall. There's nothing that connotes weightiness or grandiosity more than a grand piano, let alone 56 of them. Yet Berkeley waves his magic wand, and these behemoths suddenly become as light as feathers. They spin around like tops.
The funny thing about it is, of course, you've got 56 guys under those pianos moving them. And I just think it's amazing that 56 of them who can't see what the hell anybody else is doing, we're able to move them in synchronization, and it works.
They make this kind of amoeba kind of quality as well that is really sophisticated, and you can't imagine how he must have done that, the painstaking rehearsal.
Berkeley climaxes this whole anti-gravity theme in The Words Are in My Heart with an amazing shot. It starts by showing a single dancer on top of four pianos with her skirts swirling kind of oddly around her legs. And then the camera pulls back, and as it's doing that, all the pianos fly in from the edges of the frame and fit together with magical precision. The trick here is that the number is done in reverse motion, backwards. And that also accounts for the odd way that the dancer's skirt are kind of billowing or floating around her.
Busby Berkeley was a madman, obviously, and one that thought up something that once he got on it, you know, boy, he really didn't ever walk his way through it. He kept getting better and more insane.
Come on along and listen to the lullaby of Broadway, the hip hooray and ballyhoo, the lullaby of Broadway.
Lullaby of Broadway is just so great because it's a whole separate... It's almost, you could take that out of the film and it would work just as well. It's like a whole separate piece.
It is a great song. It's a fantastic song with very strong images in the lyrics.
I'll buy you this and that. You'll hear a daddy saying, and baby goes home to her flat to sleep all day.
I think this is a very personal number for Busby Berkeley. It's a number where he reflects on his own career and his own place in the development of the musical film. On one hand, it reflects a lot of the delirium and excess and spectacle that's associated with Berkeley's earlier numbers. But these elements start to turn in on themselves. The vast set and the shadowy lighting take on this kind of haunted house quality.
It tells a story about this couple that lives in the night. They're night owls. And so you see these wonderful shots of this couple in this huge casino nightclub. They're the only two there besides the orchestra. So that's a very haunting image.
The Dick Powell and Winnie Shaw characters, they're very debonair, somewhat in the fashion of Astaire Rogers in their musicals. But again, given a very sinister edge. It's like Astaire and Rogers with a hangover, or Astaire and Rogers gone gothic.
So now you see, in the old traditional sense, a huge amount of people with a unison tap number, with a little bit of a game playing going on, a little riff going on. You tap, I answer, you question, I answer. It's kind of call and response kind of thing going on in the structure of the dance.
These are very interesting rhythms. It's what we would call pure dance, one of the few numbers that has a sizable chunk of music that is danced too. And then again, he does some very interesting camera angles from up above. And in fact, there's a trio of men that step forward and do a specialty part of the dance, and he even shoots them from underneath. It's a plexiglass floor.
There's three tap dancers that are doing this quite eccentric tap dancing, doing what was also called legomania at that point.
Then he also has his signature wave step, and the wave is what we call when a movement starts with one dancer and then it just goes right down the row in subsequent order.
He was very aware of the rhythm. He used to believe that he was famous for his broken rhythm dances on Broadway. It's that ba-ba-bop, that syncopation that in those days we'd not seen that enough. It makes our heart leap just a little bit. So Berkeley knew the power of rhythm. That stomping is just overwhelming. Here they come. There's too many of them. They're stomping too hard. There's a very dangerous edge to them.
My sweetie may not let me.
The most aggressive tap dancing I've ever seen in my life. It is an army. It's like a cult, really, like Jim Jones or the Manson family or somebody like a totally with zombie tappers, you know, like so aggressive that they're like Night of the Living tappers. I mean, they're attacking some girl. They're forcing up, and she doesn't know. She thinks she's in this dance number, but actually they're killing her. That's a murder by tap.
Of course, the death is only in her imagination, and as she finishes taking the puff from a cigarette, you realize, oh, wait a minute, no one's died. But even in her imagination, once again, that threat that hides even in the happiest of musical numbers with Busby Berkeley. Unique. Adding a third dimension where usually only two existed.
We've all, I think, had that dream where we slip and fall, you know, off and off of a tall building or something like that. And whether Winnie Shaw actually perishes or not, that's not the point. You know, when that happens to you in the dream, you wake up before you hit. And I think that's what Berkeley's trying to suggest.
Some writers have talked about fascistic tendencies in Berkeley's numbers, such as in Lullaby of Broadway, the male dancers where they keep sticking their arm out as being like goose stepping.
I think the filmmaker that Berkeley most resembles is Leni Riefenstahl. I don't think people talk about this, but I really look at Triumph of the Will, and I know Leni Riefenstahl had watched Berkeley pictures. I'm absolutely sure of it, because those vast movements of people to a very different end, but there is a fascist tinge sometimes when they're marching. He does a lot of marching, and it's kind of like, what's going on here?
That perfect order and everything is fascistic in a way. I mean, it is scary when you see that kind of order of human beings being directed to be that perfectly in order.
What Berkeley does can slide over into fascism very easily, or that type of reading, but I think his numbers at least channel a kind of New Deal spirit. You've got the de-emphasis of star power. You've got this sort of melting pot idea in numbers like 42nd Street and Shanghai Lil, where different elements are brought together and are kind of balanced with each other rather than being all smoothed out into an undifferentiated mass.
Busby Berkeley on screen had come up with precision dancing, people really moving together in the same way at the same time. He perfected this, and one of the ultimate expressions is in Lullaby of Broadway.
He was a genius, and he was a man that you watch in awe. I mean, those movies don't date. They get better and better. Those musical numbers, you could show them to, 50 Cent would like them. I mean, you could show them to anybody, any culture, any kind of thing, and they go, wow, afterwards. It's not the kind of thing where they, oh, I've seen that. I mean, there's a kid recently I talked to in Provincetown, and I said, did you like The Wizard of Oz? And he said, basically, it's just walking. And I thought, wow, but nobody could say that about this. Nobody's ever going to say, it's just dancing.
I take great pleasure in showing some classic Cab Calloway, classic Busby Berkeley, classic movie comedy to people, because they, especially young people, they just go, wow. I mean, this isn't mediocre. This is amazing.
He changed not just musical film, but all forms of commercial film forever. He freed the camera. He didn't just give it legs, he gave it wings. And that was something that had not happened in sound film before.
His name itself means brilliant dance numbers. It has become a definition of that word. You don't have to explain anything. You just say, like Busby Berkeley, everybody knows what you mean. It means beautiful, glamorous, fully realized, amazingly functional, and beyond the normal person's imagination. And what a great legacy to leave. I'll drink to that, Busby.
Come along and listen to the lullaby of Broadway, the hidey-high and blue-blood-blue, the lullaby of Broadway. The band begins to go to town, and everyone goes crazy. Rock-a-bye your baby round, till everything gets...